Hello, my name is John Kelly, and this is the Weber Auto YouTube channel. This will be the first of a multi-part series on universal joints. And we have eight different types of universal joints we're going to be looking at here. We're going to look at some history, we're going to look at the diagnostics, the proper service work, how to replace these without destroying the drive shaft or the universal joint itself, how to check for axial play, radial play, all kinds of great things. But to do that, we need to define some things first. Have you ever wondered what are all these names associated with U-joints? There's the Cardan joint, there's the Hook joint, there's the Pelham joint, there's the Shepa joint, there's a double offset joint, there's a tripod joint, a tripod joint. There's the rubber flexible coupling, sometimes called a rag joint. There's a whole bunch of different types of, and they're all universal joints. Some of these are constant velocity universal joints. Some of them are not constant velocity joints, and we'll cover the differences between those. We'll take a look a little bit of the history of universal joints and show you some fascinating things of how a sundial is related to a discovery of how a universal joint is not a constant velocity joint. We'll talk a little bit about a gimbal and how a mathematician with the last name of Cardano has been associated with the name of a Cardan or Cardan U-joint, double Cardan U-joint, single Cardan U-joint, and how U-joints, he didn't invent those at all, even though there's plenty of websites that says he did. I'll show you some research by some professional people that have will show us who really did what, and we'll take that all the way up through Mr. Clarence Spicer, who actually, he did not invent the U-joint, of course, but he's the first one to patent and design a U-joint for use in an automobile with an oil bath that would last a long time without having constant service work being done on it, and how that has, how that initial invention from Mr. Spicer had grown into a huge corporation, Dana Corporation, that we know today. And so we'll take a look at all these different universal joints. Once again, the service, diagnostic, and repair on these things. And there's a lot more to it than most people think. One of the common questions that I receive from technicians is, I just replaced a U-joint on my vehicle and now there's a vibration. Could it be a bad U-joint, or what did I do wrong? There's all kinds of things that you could have done wrong. And there's a possibility that you did nothing wrong. It's just the universal joint that you're using might be garbage. We're going to compare eight different universal joints, different brands of universal joints, some made in China, some made in the United States. There's one made in China that says made in USA right on it. We'll take a look at their measurements, the quality of their construction, and the differences between a good quality U-joint that automobile manufacturers use right out of the factory, brand new, and a lot of the garbage that is sold in auto parts stores around the country for real cheap. A lot of people think that all U-joints are the same and the only difference is the price. So buy a $12 U-joint instead of a $60 U-joint. Well, there is a difference. And yes, it's more money to get the quality one, but hopefully by the end of this series on universal joints, you'll know what the difference is and why you would want to pay for the better universal joint than for the garbage one. And so let's just quickly take a look at the different types of things we're going to cover in this series, and then we'll get started with some history and background. Okay, in our second episode coming up, we will compare universal joint quality. I have here on the table eight different brands of universal joints. Two of them are brand new factory universal joints, and then we have several, or all the others are aftermarket replacement universal joints, and we will look at the differences between them. I have on these two boards here that we'll look in great detail a comparison of a factory U-joint produced by Spicer, and then an aftermarket U-joint, the one I told you about that was made in China, but it's cast right on it, says made in the USA. It appears to be a direct copy of another U-joint, but there are some differences, some major differences between these universal joints. And so We will take a look at the differences between those. I've got this board here that we'll take a look at also, the differences in the snap rings. We have universal joint snap rings that come in different thicknesses to control axial endplay. And that's something that should and can be measured to diagnose whether or not your U-joint is centered and whether or not it's excessively worn, even though it hasn't totally failed. And so we will learn how to do that in the service portion of this multi-part series. Okay, in another episode coming up, we will cover the six different types of constant velocity joints that are currently used in production vehicles of today. And these six joints are the tripod or tripot joint. We have the double offset joint. We have the cross groove joint. We have the SHEPA joint. We have the flexible rubber coupling. And then we have what is incorrectly referred to as the double cardan U-joint system. But people are going to call it that forever. So we'll make sure you know what the real name of it should be. But people are hard to change. They're not going to call it anything different than what they've heard over the years. We'll cover diagnosing constant velocity half shafts and the proper terminology, link shafts, half shafts, torsional dampers, what types of joints are used where. If you've got a rear-wheel drive vehicle, which one of these joints do you have? If you have a front-wheel drive vehicle, which one do you have? Which one is the inboard joint? Which one is the outboard joint? How do you diagnose them? Because you do not diagnose them all the same. Some have normal movement in and out, axial movement. Some do not. And so we will go through all of that, as well as which ones can be serviced, which ones you can disassemble, inspect for damage, replace the boots, the clamps. We'll talk about three different types of boot clamps, the earless clamps, the one with the ears, and then the ones that you have to use a swage clamp to compress in place. We'll go through all of that in this series. Okay, in another episode of this series, we will cover the proper tools that you need to properly remove and reinstall universal joints and do the diagnostics with them. The proper tool to use, as I was taught when I was a young technician, is not a hammer and a chisel. sorry guys, that's not the right way to do it. You may be able to occasionally get by with that, but there are tools made for that, and some are not very expensive at all and are really cool. We've got some factory tools here, U-joint presses. We've got a ball joint press back here in the vise that there's a special adapter for that you can get. This is a Ford special tool. This is a General Motors special tool. I'll show you another tool that you probably have that you can convert to make into a U-joint press without damaging or bending any of those ears that the U-joint bearing caps have to go through. If you bend those things, those holes are line bored, and if you bend them, then they're not aligned any longer, and the universal joint either won't go in properly or it will fail. And you know what I'm talking about. There are joints that I've put in over the years that were really, really tight no matter what I did. And some of that could have been the wrong snap rings, as we'll talk about in one of our episodes. But some of it definitely could have been that I hit it too hard with a hammer and bent one of the ears and got it out of alignment. We will also, as I mentioned in, before, look at CV boot replacement, the different types of earless and ear type clamps, and the tools that go with those, the swage tools to compress them, and so on. We will go through the whole replacement and reinstallation procedure to make sure that when you replace a universal joint or diagnose a universal joint, that there's not a vibration when you're done with it. Okay, in another episode, we will look at actual on-vehicle and on-bench diagnostics, how to hook up a dial indicator and do an axial endplay check. Different manufacturers have different maximum axial up and down or radial rotational endplay checks that you have to measure with a dial indicator setup like we've got here. Obviously, if you can feel play, it's bad, but you can have a bad U-joint that's out of spec with end play that you cannot feel. For example, most of these U-joints have a maximum axial end play of just under 2/1000ths of an inch. Most people can't feel 2/1000ths of an inch end play. You have to measure it. And so we will take you through the process of measuring axial, radial end play, propeller shaft runout, flange runout, all kinds of things on drive shafts, drive lines, etc. We will also go through the same measurements on constant velocity joints. This one I've cut the shaft off, so it's easier to for me to handle, but there are checks that you can do to see how much, to see if there's in and out play. Some should have it, some should not. How much radial play there should be. You can check all of that also. Okay, in another episode, we are going to look at the different types of drive shafts and drive lines, and we'll define the difference between a drive line and a drive shaft. We will look at different companion flange styles, where these drive shafts and drive lines hook up. Several different styles of companion flanges here, and specialty tools to check for companion flange runout to see if they're bent. If somebody's whacked on them too hard with a hammer when they were trying to take them off to change a pinion shaft seal or whatever, instead of using a puller, it's a fairly common thing. So there's specialty tools for checking runout and seeing if there's any problems with these. We'll take a look at the different types of slip yokes and the service and the diagnostics on those. We'll take a look at one piece, two piece, and so on, and talk about three, four, or five, doesn't matter how many piece, drive shafts, and make sure that you understand how all of that works and the proper terminology and proper service and diagnostic work associated with all of these. All of these shafts are non-constant velocity shafts, which means they speed up and slow down twice per revolution as they rotate if the universal joints have any angle at all to them. So these shafts, if the U-joint working angles are incorrect, which we'll talk about how to measure, and I have another video on that also, then you can end up with a terrible vibration. And so, but having the incorrect U-joint, the wrong U-joint end play, axial play, the wrong centering of the U-joint, two different C-clips, different thicknesses of the snap rings that hold the U-joint in. I didn't even know they came in different thicknesses until a couple years ago. I just put in it what came in the box. But there are things that you can do when replacing a universal joint on a drive shaft that can cause a vibration, and you didn't even know that you did it. So I'll show you how to avoid those. And finally, in another episode, we will talk about constant velocity drive shafts and drive lines, and the different types of constant velocity shafts and what makes them constant velocity. We will learn about the rubber flexible coupling universal joint and how this thing works, and the trilobal yoke that it goes with, and how this thing can transfer enough torque that it's used in high performance vehicles all over the world with independent rear suspension. We will look at constant velocity joints on these constant velocity shafts. We've got a Shepa joint here, we've got a double cardan U-joint here, we've got the flexible rubber coupling. These are all constant velocity joints, but only if they're installed and angled correctly. There's a unique pinion flange right here for a constant velocity joint to connect to. And then there are special service tools that bolt up to the flange, so you can check for flange runout to see if, as you spin it, put a dial indicator on here and see if it has excessive up and down movement, as if the pinion gear were bent or the flange itself were bent, maybe after an accident. We will talk about replacing center support bearings and servicing the double cardan joints, for lack of a better term. At the moment, it's actually a double hooks joint. But according to the SAE standard J901, these are all just universal joints of different styles. So this will be a fun series. There's a lot to it, as you can see, and I think you'll learn a lot. I certainly learned a lot preparing for this series. It's taken me several months just to gather all the parts and the information I need just to be able to shoot this. So once again, this is the Weber Auto YouTube channel. This is at Weber State University in Ogden, Utah, where we have a wonderful automotive technology program with both associate degree programs and bachelor degree programs. Have a good day.